Hello there. In world animation, one nation's industry who you have seen more than you would think is the Canadian one. A couple number of the shows, and even some features you have watched or currently watch, are done in the land of maple syrup and beavers. Outsourced Canadian animation began in the early 60s, but it would become an industry that would truly become a major force in the late 70s, when a major Hollywood filmmaker commissioned a small studio to work on an infamous television special. Nelvana was asked by George Lucas to make a short cartoon segment for the notorious Star Wars Holiday Special in 1978, which finally allowed the outfit to show off their skills to the few who tuned in. This allowed them the opportunity to make a feature film in the form of Rock and Roll. A rock musical set in a futuristic world, the story may not have been that strong, but the visuals and creative character designs gave it enough of a unique vibe to offset the typical sci-fi story. It was also made around a time with more adult animated features given theatrical releases thanks to the success of Ralph Bakshi. However, Rock and Roll was a box office bomb due to lack of promotion, and Nelvana almost went bankrupt. This actually led them to work on productions for the polar opposite audience. Pun intended. Around the same time, Ivan Reitman produced Heavy Metal, based on the popular French magazine. This was a pastiche of stories as cobbled together by National Film Board director Gerald Poddington, with each segment being quite creative and certainly pulling the limits of what animation could do. The whole thing is pretty much boyhood fantasy, but considering the source material is a pulp magazine, it's understandable in context. However, Heavy Metal also never really took off on its cinematic release, though it did manage to gain a major cult following for television airings. Back to Nelvana, the failure of Rock and Roll really crippled them financially, but they managed to get back into the game when a greeting card company asked them to make a feature film based on their Care Bears property. The result was a high-grossing film that also led to a popular television series. Thus, Nelvana became the top animation studio in Canada, with many American toy and movie companies wanting them to develop their products into animated series. Lucas even returned to them to help make animated series starring the droids and Ewoks from Star Wars. Even Tim Burton contacted them to make a Beetlejuice cartoon for television. During the 90s, they found themselves being contracted to adapt a lot of films into animated series, such as Ace Ventura, Free Willy, and The NeverEnding Story. Okay, those are pretty stupid. But Nelvana also saw properties of their own, looking a lot at European stories to adapt into series. Babar and Rupert were particularly inspired discoveries, and The Adventures of Tintin is probably the best production to hold the studio's name. They even tried their hand at another animated feature with Pippi Longstocking, which spawned a series of its own. The original properties were quite decent themselves, with Ned's Newt being a particular highlight, but you've heard me rave about that one plenty of times before. When it comes to notable Canadian animation houses, few can top the impressive catalog of Nelvana. Meanwhile, Deke Entertainment was also a top company for outsourced animation with such hit shows like Captain Planet and The Real Ghostbusters. They also handled comic properties like Heathcliff and Dennis the Menace, as well as video game adaptations of Super Mario Bros. And Legend of Zelda. Yeah, most of them weren't very good. However, of their show adaptations, Sonic the Hedgehog was definitely the strongest, as it took the basic concept of the video game and ran with it, creating a series that had a dark element with Sutherland's approach, had fun action, and even some emotion. Plus, when the unresolved cliffhanger annoys you, you know it does something right. However, Deke also created an original property that worked extremely well with Inspector Gadget. With the creative premise of a policeman of all sorts of robotic functions, they hit upon a jackpot. This had humor, adventure, and an unforgettable theme song, not to mention the voice of Don Adams. There's a reason I immediately think of Inspector Gadget when Deke is brought up. A number of years back, Deke merged with another Canadian studio, Cinar, to form Cookie Jar. Cinar tackled shows more for a younger audience, like The Busy World of Richard Scarry and Paddington Bear, but still had a solid group. Of course, with Nelvana and Deke getting the attention of the American production houses, other animation studios have to find their own ways of success. Case in point is Kevin Gillis's The Raccoons. Made for the CBC television network, the show was a sweet environmental story that was more subtle than you would expect. It also featured a fun set of characters and a villain who wasn't all black and white, despite being the typical developer. The animation actually managed to surpass that of Nelvana and Deke at the time, and it's no surprise that it continues to have a huge fan base. In addition to the animation, Gillis also spared no expense on the soundtrack, with the theme song Run With Us being one of the best songs to come out in the 1980s, and was also featured in a fantastic music video. The Raccoons is definitely one of the best animated series to be made entirely in Canada. I've been spending most of this video looking over animated family shows. However, like a lot of American networks following the initial success of The Simpsons, Canadian studios were in high demand to make animated series for adults. Like their American counterparts, most of them did not take off and have long since been forgotten. One of them did really well, though, and that was Nelvana's Bob and Margaret. Based on the Oscar-winning short Bob's Birthday, the show ran for 4 seasons on global television, and it was very funny. Utilizing a very British sense of humor, the series tackled the mundane life of a married couple and their adventures. It doesn't sound very exciting, but the subtle comedy is what made it work so well. For the 3rd season, the characters moved to Toronto due to Canadian content regulations, and this allowed the creators, Alison Snowden and David Fine, to make jokes about culture clashes. However, the writers didn't overload it with references to Toronto life, and let the characters' British feeling lead to the comedy. It also understands how to write an adult animated series without resulting to sophomoric humor. The show is actually surprisingly addictive, in that after watching one episode, you want to sit through another. I'm a huge fan of the original short, and this show complemented it well. But since Bob and Margaret, what adult Canadian animation have we experienced? Oh, wow. I've criticized Seth MacFarlane's shows for looking like Go Animate software, but that looks like the most low-end version of Flash animation I've seen. It doesn't help by how uninspired the writing is. Yes, in recent years, Canadian animation has become notorious for lower quality animated shows produced with Flash, and yep, most of them are pretty trite. One notorious example is Johnny Test, which is continually renewed despite being a thinly veiled attempt to cash in on the likes of Dexter's Lab and Jimmy Neutron, and lacking any of their charm and creativity. It's not helped by its dull character designs. But not all of these Flash animated shows are bottom of the barrel quality. Kid vs. Kat is a show that not only knows how to use technology, but the scripts are funny too. Evolving around a boy named Coop and his sister's evil alien cat, the writers actually make these characters interesting and hilarious, with the animation evoking the necessary madcap feel, while getting too hyperactive to the point of dizziness. It's not a series that's gotten a lot of attention, but it's definitely a solid show worth tuning into when you get the chance. While Canadian animated series have had the highs and lows, as the title of this video suggests, they've been more prevalent in our childhoods and animation-watching lifetime than you might think. Whether done by Nelvana or Deke or Studio B Productions, chances are you will certainly remember them for quite a while. See you next time.